Hi, good evening, everyone. Am I audible to everyone at the back? Great. So how's everyone doing this evening? So how many of you are interested to learn more about travel retail? So we spoke a lot about all the we spoke a lot about retail outside of this space. I was quite impressed by this range of speakers who came up here, gave us a lot of insight into offline, digital, security. So some very interesting topics going around. And as you might have realized, I'm going to shift the scene a bit and take you into the travel retail space and see how we can make the travel retail experience more engaging, more exciting for the customer. Right? So could you tell me what this picture brings to mind? Any guesses what this looks like? None. Great. So we have some people who know the history of travel retail, and so this is in fact, I mean, to me, when I first saw the store, and it probably looks like some of the bakery formats that we see around town. But this is in fact the first duty-free store, started back in 1947 at Shannon Island, and since then, duty-free shopping has become a common part of travel experience. So people expect to go to duty-free shop and find something either to buy, maybe an F&B outlet, right? So that's a bit. And let's look at some numbers on what this segment is worth. So as of 2017, it was worth $68.6 billion. And what's it going to look like in the future? $125 billion. In the next 5 years, travel retail is expected to grow by almost 100%, it's about 90%+, but almost 100% growth in the segment. So that's one reason to be excited about travel retail. So let's look a bit about who is traveling. How many millennials do we have in the audience today? A few at the back. Okay, great. Any Gen Zs? No, they should probably not be here. They should be at school today. And baby boomers? No baby boomers? Okay. So let's look at what these demographics mean for the travel retail industry. So this is how the traveler profile is changing. We're looking at an increase in millennials to make up 50% of the travel. 50% of the travelers, more than 50% of the travelers, and followed by the Gen Z, who are actually growing at quite a fast rate. So it's 40% increase in Gen Z's traveling. And why this segment is important, obviously, because it makes up 80% of the travel retail shoppers, but also because, like some of the earlier speakers mentioned, they are the ones taking the forefront of the shopping experience. They're the ones who people are trying to target, get it right for. And it's mainly around, they're not as patient. So 60% of them are less likely to use an app or a website if it takes time to load. So we saw a lot of data around that. And those kind of preferences are likely to spill over into their travel shopping preferences as well. So it's important for the retailers and for the brands to try and engage with them in a better way, in a faster way to get them to buy. So I was mentioning there's a fall in numbers, and that's coming from the baby boomers who are going to travel less, right? And what do you think passengers are consuming? What are some of the popular segments in travel retail that gets the revenue, the numbers that we spoke about? Cosmetics, liquor, perfumes. Okay, great. So this is data as of last year, and some of you rightly said, fragrance and cosmetics make up over 36%, followed by wines and spirits. And in the third position is fashion and accessories. Not too far away is also tobacco. So you can see here that there's a lot of, we can probably club that, like 50% of that into the luxury goods. So luxury goods are what's doing well in travel retail, what seems to be popular among the shoppers. So how many of you here travel often? Can I have a show of hands? Yeah, you travel a lot. So I've been fortunate to travel a bit in the last couple of years, and I've noticed that sometimes when you're moving from airport to airport, you don't really get a sense of where you are. You're just landing out of a plane. Maybe you just woke up. You've been woken up and told to leave the plane because you've reached your destination. So you're moving from one white building to the other. And this kind of leads to this monotony around the space. And you don't get a sense of place. And here I was at this airport, and immediately I knew I'd landed in India, or if not specifically in Delhi. So this brings me to my first point, which is regarding creating sense of place. So creating a sense of place helps the customer feel an authentic, builds an authentic relationship with where they've landed. And this can be either within the airport environment or also within the retail space. So it helps bring the customer on board in terms of getting into the retail experience. And so the first key to succeeding is working on your design. So how many of you have heard of the word social currency? Not really? OK. So social currency, with the demographics that we were looking at, is probably the next most important currency after the dollar, because brands are using social currency as a way of creating engagement. And we spoke about in the earlier panel discussion, we were talking about the likes of the pop-up shops and things like that. And social currency is nothing but creating spaces where people like to take a break and take a picture and share it online. So it's creating this noise about your brand through that social engagement. So we've had the opportunity to work with a couple of brands in the last few years. And this was one that a confectionery brand did. And they actually ran this campaign across 50 airports. So they were encouraged to make a purchase from KitKat, and they were given a selfie stick and asked to take a break, obviously, as the KitKat tagline goes. And this was then shared online, and it created a lot of social currency for the brand. And now talking about pop-up shops, so this is another example of how dead space within the retail can be converted into for better user experience. So in this case, we had an AR thing running at the center, and it was during the FIFA. It was during a FIFA event, so you could actually go on there, where the AR. I'm just gonna. Sorry. Yeah. So where the AR goggles and try on, and passengers walking by were also able to experience this. So they could see you playing in the background, and they were actually lining up and wanting to try it themselves. So it's a great way also to engage the customer. And also retailers within the duty-free space are looking for brands to come in and do creative activations to make the passengers feel special. So they are actually not just looking to rent the space, but also looking to create experiences for the passengers landing and taking long transits. So I'll just put that. So I happened to walk past immigration at one of the airports, and walked into a great store that was well located, obviously, because just outside the immigration. And I sort of knew what I was looking for. So I went into the store, and I expected at some point that a salesman would come and approach me, start talking to me regarding what I was looking for. This didn't happen, so I sort of knew what I wanted. I was looking for handcrafted soap that seemed to be a popular gift at airports. So I went, I picked it up. I walked to the cashier, made my transaction, and as I walked out here, I realized there was no greeting, there was no transaction as such. It was almost automated, it was almost robotic, which made me sort of rate the experience a 3 out of 10. On the other hand, while I was flying here, I happened to meet with a friend, and he wanted to do some shopping. So I decided to join him on his journey. And as we went into the store, he was actually greeted by his name. And I asked him, hey, did you know that guy? And he said, no, not really. I do come here frequently as I travel out of this airport. And it just made me think that this brand had gone to great lengths to invest in training their people. So which brings me to my second key, which is about people. So when we talk about people in travel retail, it's very critical for the following reasons. And these are some of the questions that you should probably ask if you are if you are present in travel retail, do your salespersons or your brand ambassadors have the emotional intelligence? So you're dealing with customers who are in various states of mind going through the airport. So you want to know if they're able to recognize and interact with them accordingly. Are they culturally aware? Do they know, for example, how to greet or deal with a Japanese customer versus, let's say, an Arab customer? So you want to make, are they able to make that differentiation? And as we saw with the kind of products that are being sold, with luxury products, there's obviously a lot of heritage in those brands. And the people who are buying some of these luxury goods already possess a lot of knowledge. They're probably brand loyal. So you want your salesperson to be able to aid that further or be able to add to that knowledge to the customer. So they need to have that product knowledge. And finally, like my friend had experienced, can they provide faultless, understated service rather than, let's say, a pushy salesman trying to sell you more? So that's a bit about what we should be looking at in terms of people. So do you think your product mix that works in your domestic market, and if you copy-pasted that into travel retail, would that work? No? Why not? Okay. Any others? Right. Okay. The type of customers differ as well. Yeah. So this brings me to my third key point, which is about product mix. And why? Let's look at why product mix is important when choosing to go into travel retail. So travel retail, and especially consumers going to travel retail, are really looking for exclusivity. Exclusivity is a big word around travel retail product lines, and brands are constantly competing to launch an exclusive one product after the other. Another thing around is also, let's say, minis. People are looking for miniatures of products. It also somehow links into the restrictions around travel retail. So certain liquids, you can't carry a certain amount. So these are things you want to find in travel retail. It's a great place to think global, act local. So when I say when a brand is trying to enter into a new market, it's a good idea to then come in. Let's say if they're coming into the Indian market and a new cosmetic brand, maybe launch a skincare product that goes with the Indian skin tone. So it's a good place to try that, and it works. It's shown that it works well. And most importantly, we are talking about limited space. So another reason why you can't bring your whole product line into travel retail space is, let's say you got X square meter within a mall, you probably get X by 4 if you're really lucky and you're a big brand. Initially, you'd probably just get a wall space. So space is really limited, and people are competing for that space. So you really want to choose, what products would work for that segment, and then go into travel retail. Right? So how many of us have had a delayed flight? A lot of you? Okay. So that's a common experience. So I actually found an interesting example of how that negative emotion was used by a brand to convert into a positive feel. So let's have a look at this video.
Flying high up in the sky.
So great way to engage with their customers when they're feeling down and to get their spirits up high. Means giving a free few freebies, few free chocolates, but I think the brand gains a lot more. So social currency and those things we talked about. And this brings me to my fourth key to succeeding travel retail, which is technology. So technology, like we've again heard a lot about today, you can't keep technology out of retail. It's an integral part of retail, be it the simple part of making a payment transaction simple, cashless payments, accepting multiple currencies, etc., which is really important for travel retail. So you make sure that the technology that you have helps your customer transact, but also makes it more interesting for them in this space. So I'm not going to talk much about the technology, but I'm going to show you a couple of other interesting examples that I came across. Another one is we all spend a lot of time at the boarding gate. So let's say most of us are there about an hour before the flight has to take off. On average, we spend, let's say, about an hour there. And this app found it a good space to be in and get customers deliveries from across the airport. So within 15 minutes, you could place an order and get it delivered to your boarding gate. So it was a great way for Deliveroo to bring you your, let's say, food to the boarding gate. So that time, 1 hour, which is dead time for the retailers who they couldn't sell to you, this was an opportunity. So you open the Deliveroo app in the, this was tested at the Netherlands airports. You could basically see the retail on offer, mainly F&B, and you could get it delivered to your gate. And a third example was also around pop-up shops, and here again using AR, where they allowed customers to try on different lipstick shades without actually having to try them on. So you could try those on, capture the VR code, share it again online, so creating. But also if you want to get a makeover, they also had that option. There's a big screen on the side where you could actually see all the lipstick colors that were trending in the area. So it was a great way for them to engage with the customer. Great. So how many of us have actually discovered a brand for the first time in travel retail? Any of you discovered a brand when you were traveling? No, not so much? OK, a couple of you. Great. So I've actually discovered a few brands. And one that comes to mind is Pret, which is actually a sandwich shop, and they do organic coffee and things like that. And the only shop that I've seen in the region is the one in Dubai. So when I fly out of Dubai, I see the Pret store, and it actually has quite nice produce. They do localize it a bit. And I think they've been there about 3 years, and I also recently read that they are now planning to open into the domestic market. So my last key is actually why you should be in travel retail more than how. So it's literally your opportunity for your brand to take off. So it's a brand's window to the world. Research has shown that customers are in a receptive frame of mind. So Huzaifa also mentioned that consumers are more likely to purchase. They're more in that frame of mind where they're ready to part with their money. So it is a good space to catch the consumer when they're going abroad. And it's a good platform to test going abroad. So being at the airport in a new country allows you to get a feel of the consumer taste and probably the right kind of customers who are willing to spend a bit. So it'll also help you establish your product mix before you have to go into the market in full scale. Yeah. So yeah, that's it from me. Those are the five keys that I'd encourage you to take away. Oh yes, and the most important reason why you should be there is because the market's growing at that size. So there's a lot of money to be had if you get your travel retail right. So thank you for this opportunity. And I'm open to any questions if you'd like to go ahead.